I'm here to talk to you about a suite of 8 mobile apps that was produced as a collaboration between 7 museums in Australia. I'm also going to introduce a little bit of science into the Best in Heritage. We haven't had much science, well, we've had different types of science, but this is natural history that you're going to hear about in this project. Our project not only won a Museum for the Web Award, but won a couple of other awards as well. So it won a Museums and Galleries National Awards in Australia, and also won a Bronze Muse Award in the Mobile Applications category. So, but let's first start with users. Why would we build these apps? Who are they for, and what were we hoping people would do with them? So people have been studying plants and animals for hundreds of years, and naming species and describing their characteristics is a branch of biological science called taxonomy. And you'll find most taxonomists work in museums and herbaria. So museums are very well placed to produce something like field guide apps. But it's not just scientists who are interested in naming things, it's all of us. Whenever we go into the forest or down to the beach and we see an animal, that looks interesting, we say, well, what is it? What's its name? So everyone is interested in science at some level. Over the past few years, there's also been a rise in popularity of what has been called citizen science. And the one thing citizen scientists are encouraged to do is help out other scientists by doing field surveys, wildlife counts, and doing things like take photographs of animals that they see and record their observations. In Australia, children are often taught about the animals in their environment by doing surveys in their own schoolyard, in a local park, or nature reserve. In this photograph, we've got a couple of real-life museum scientists helping with an education program on one of our bioblitzes, where we went and did a huge survey. Birdwatching is a very popular hobby, indeed a passion for many people. And people are also... You don't have to be a dedicated bird watcher to be interested in nature. You might just see something while you're out on a bushwalk, something like one of those iconic Australian animals up there. Or you might just see something, a new bird that you haven't seen before, fly into your own backyard. Or one of your children might have been digging around in the dirt and found an interesting insect or creepy crawly and want to know what it is. So field guides help people to identify the things that they find and see. They're traditionally done as a printed publication, and you can see some of the printed publications by my museum down at the bottom of the slide. The trouble with those is that as you get more interested in more and more different types of animals, you've got to take more books with you when you go out into the bush, and that starts to get a bit heavy. So luckily, mobile technology provides us with an answer and replaces all those heavy books with just one device. With Field Guide on a mobile device, that you can put in as many species as you want, with as many images as you want, as many maps as you like, and you can write as much text as you want to as well, without the device getting any heavier at all. You can also add things like sound files, which of course are impossible in a printed publication. I will say though, that there is a limit to even with mobile devices, which is that eventually, if you put too many species or too many high-resolution photographs in, that eventually your users start complaining that the download is too big or that they can't do it over Wi-Fi. But luckily for us, that limit is quite high. So, our collaborative project started with 7 museums around the country receiving a grant from our federal government under the Inspiring Australia Grant Initiative. My museum had already previously produced a field guide app just for Victorian species, so we could already say that we had the technical skills to do the project. Many users of the existing app were also saying to us, when are you going to do one for my state? When are you going to do one for where I live? And so we had users already saying to us that they wanted more. So the grant was pretty generous. It was enough to fund a project manager and an Android programmer. And each partner, each museum around the country who was partnering with us, received a share to help to produce the content. My museum was the lead of the project, and the rest of what we needed including the Apple developer and the designer, were provided as in-kind by my museum. So the deliverables of the project were pretty ambitious. We had to produce 8 field guide apps, and each app needed to have fauna that was unique to that geographic area. So there wasn't much point in making 8 field guide apps that all had the same content in them. So the field guide app, for example, for the northern part of Australia, the one for the Northern Territory and the one for Queensland, both include animals like crocodiles and termites, and the app for Tasmania, for example, includes fur seals and penguins, so different species for different parts of Australia. The app for Western Australia, which is the geographically sort of most separate, even though Tasmania is a separate island, Western Australia is separated by a very large desert, and so the most number of unique species are actually found over in Western Australia. And each partner was asked to supply at least 200 species descriptions along with photographs. So the species descriptions, we had a big long master list of all the species that we thought we wanted to include, and we divided them up so we didn't have two museums both writing a species profile for the one species. The partners also needed to find photographs and sound files. We found sound files for birds and for frogs, and all partners had to get those appropriately licensed if they didn't have them in their own collection. So we wanted to make sure that our photographers were properly credited and properly acknowledged. The apps had to be delivered for both Android and Apple devices, and when they finally went into the app stores, they had to be available for free. So that was an interesting thing for some of the museums to negotiate with their museum board, for example, if that, particularly for the ones who'd already been experimenting with paid apps. We also in Australia have a project called the Atlas of Living Australia, which is Australia's national science aggregator. All of the museums involved in the project also provide data into the Atlas of Living Australia, and it has data on pretty much every species. And so from the Atlas, we could derive information about the taxonomy, the naming, and the classification of each animal. We could get the base data to create the maps in the app, and we could also get the conservation status, so whether the species is endangered or plentiful. We even actually, in a couple of cases, included species that were extinct, which was a sort of funny thing to include in the field guide app, but there you go. So, the final product. We're very pleased to say that all the aims were met. The apps were produced for Apple and Android devices and have a different layout depending on what screen size you're using, whether you're using a mobile phone or a tablet. When you open the app, there's a list of groups of animals, and you can browse those either taxonomically or alphabetically, or you can do a search. Once you've decided what group of animals you're interested in, you get a list of species to choose from to investigate further. Deciding what species you think you're looking at or what you're interested in, you get a species profile page that has one or more images, and those images can also be shown up at full screen size. You also have sound files for birds, frogs, some fish, believe it or not, and some mammals and insects. There's more data as well, which includes the species name, classification, a map of recorded observations, a description of the animal and its identifying characteristics, and some extra information for some types of animals. So for example, the time when the butterflies fly, or the time of the year that the frogs call. I'll just tell you a little bit about one of the interesting parts of the project, which was to decide on what the home screen would look like. We had to have a few goes at this because it was a bit difficult to try and find some images that we thought would make a suite of apps. We really wanted the apps to all look like they belong together. Each partner was asked to choose a colour, and so they chose colours that reflected the branding of their organisation. And after a few goes, we finally decided that we would use historic images. John Gould, a famous author and famous historic author, provided many beautiful images that we could use. And so each of the apps uses either the bird emblem for their state or the mammal emblem for their state, coming from John Gould's publications. So, and you can see that from the, in the mobile view on the screen, you can see all those historic images that then turned up in, then were compiled into the home screens with the colours. And we thought they looked rather good. In all, the apps have over 2,100 species. They have over 7,000 photos across them and 250 audio files. Each app individually has somewhere between 700 and 900 species. So there's a little bit of crossover for some widely distributed animals across Australia. The apps have indeed been a success. If you look at just raw download numbers, they've been downloaded over 190,000 times across all the platforms. We've done a major upgrade since we went live to ensure that the code base keeps up with the changing software requirements. But the best thing to celebrate, and what we really got the awards for, was the collaboration. Around the whole country, between our seven partners, in the end we counted up that over 325 people had contributed to the app, either writing text, providing photographs, or providing sound files. So the text and the images were provided by curators, collection managers, volunteers, honorary associates, many people were involved with the making of the app. In some cases even, it was a citizen scientist who provided some of the images of the rarer species that we couldn't find a photograph of in any of our museum collections. And so that was really, we actually ran a little competition at one stage to say, hey, has anyone got a photo? All we offered them was tickets to the museum and the chance to have your photograph in the app. And that was enough for people to participate. We were very, very happy. And of course, I'm standing here talking to you today, but of course, the people I really need to be thanking and acknowledging are the people in the development team at Museum Victoria, without whose hard work and dedication, the project would never have gotten off the ground. So the next time you happen to be in Australia, make sure you download this fantastic free field guide app to the animals and the animals that you might see. We know that the most popular things to look at within the apps, particularly for visitors to Australia, are all the nasty things. We know Australia has a very good reputation for having scary things to see, and we know that aside from the birds, the things that people mostly look at, particularly visitors from overseas, are the crocodiles, the snakes, and the spiders. So there's plenty of those for you to enjoy in the app. And if you're ever in Australia, please make sure to download it. Thanks.